Here, do like wild lettuce. Ate the seed heads. There are plants growing up by camp that they're not bothering. I'll have to make sure some of that seed gets done. I have a little channel here that serves as a reservoir of water for the pond, and it's up to the pretty close up to this level here where it begins to broaden out. One more rain and I'll have a good reservoir of rain in here. When I was watering my little seedlings a lot, this step right there was above the water, right in there. That was above the water. So that's a good maybe 4 inches. Maybe it was below that yet, so maybe the water level might have came up 5 inches. Hip hip hooray. I wasn't worried. This is a service tree and the deer ate all the leaves off of it. Well, I guess I gotta get them caged. Hopefully it comes back. Wow, I can't believe it. Huh. And they're eating the comfrey. I don't mind that. Comfrey comes back very easy. If that service tree dies, I'm going to want to kill all the deer. Wait a second here. I do want to kill the deer. Anyway. I drew down this ferment tank and I thought, well, I better get I'm going to get a little sample of this water. I'm going to take a little sample of this ferment water here. And I got it drawn down pretty good. Can't get much more out of it. This barrel was full. I want to demonstrate how incredibly thick and rich looking this ferment water is. Look at that. I was afraid to pour it on straight when I first started making ferment water. I always diluted it with rainwater. But now I'm putting it on straight with very good results. The garden beds are lush. I did a good number on this bed this morning. I grabbed a few more slugs out of here and threw them down to the pond. Maybe a duck will eat them. I don't know. But I thinned them out, took out all the bad leaves, took out most of the leaves that were closer to the ground, get them growing up. And transplanted some rutabaga that were small. The couple that I transplanted 3 days ago are still alive, so I'm trying it again. So these three here have been transplanted in here. Two of them came from right next to that big one right there. Maybe in a week I'll pull all the rest of the turnips out of here. And this will be primarily a bed of rutabaga then. But there's some beets growing in here, some carrots. What else do I see? An onion. Parsnip. Dill. Up, up, up. There it is. Dill. I wonder if this is fennel here. Oh, that might be a dill too. So I threw out a dozen or so slugs 3 days ago when I was here. And I threw out another half a dozen. I could tell the difference. Oops, that's a pea plant I got clipped. I could tell the difference. There was a lot less chewing going on from throwing those dozen out. So I'm going to be here tomorrow morning yet. I'll take another look early in the morning. I got maybe four or five slugs out of that straw. They were heading for that straw. That's where they're hiding during the day. So I'll ruffle up that straw again and sift through it.
So here's a rutabaga I should transplant too. See that? What's this here? I don't know what that is. That might be a rutabaga too. And here's another one. You know, if I could take those three out of there,
as long as they're living, after transplant, I don't know what they're going to grow to be like.
So here's a leaf I missed here. This dying out because it's got so much chew marks and it's underneath the canopy of everything else. That's what I've been taking out of here. Here's another one. Here's another one right here. Where did this one come from? One right there. All chewed up by the slugs. So I don't necessarily like turnips that much. If I cook them, they're good. They're okay. Harvesting them early and when they're young, I think it's better, but I don't know for sure. That's just what I think. Gotta use my instincts. The nobility did their best to rid the planet of people who know what to how to take care of themselves. You know, they want us all dependent on their money systems, their financial systems, and their growing systems, so that all the surpluses they can harvest through their financial system. They get the money, and then they get to buy whatever they want. They don't want anybody taking care of themselves like I'm trying to do here. I mean, now they're so fat and happy, they don't give a shit about nothing. There's another rutabagas here that I could transplant. But if I pull this turnip out of here, then they'll have some space. Maybe transplant one. I don't know what else is up here. And there's another two different types of rutabaga here. Can I plant two different types? So interesting to consider everything that's going on. Just one garden bed. I took a half pail full of little turnips out of here 3 days ago. I want those big monster rutabagas like I grew last year here. We'll see what happens. Now that I've drawn this ferment tank down, can't get much more out of it. I'm gonna pour these pails of water in there, replenish it. Now I don't have to go down to the pond to get water. Easy. Almost made it. Close. I had one pail that wasn't positioned well. If I had that positioned well, I'd have made it right to the top. So now I know. With a good rain, those series of buckets are enough to fill up the ferment tank. Of course, if you get in rain, I don't have to do as much watering, so I'll do the ferment thing next week again. This will be for next week. Assuming I come up here next weekend, we'll see. But because it's been raining, this morning is a morning I'm going to dedicate to building up the firewood for deer hunting season. Yeah, I'm going to go have a cup of coffee, and then I'm going to start. Yesterday I was out in the woods doing a little deer scouting, checking on a trail camera, and I got caught in a downpour, so I propped these clothes up here. Maybe they'll dry off enough, because I'm making these clothes wet now, walking around. And I can switch back. Mashed up leaves from differing plants here for the differing elements and microbes from in front of camp. Three notable would be yarrow and comfrey and stinging nettles. I got a thistle leaf in there, some grasses. Almost all of the garden plants that are here got a leaf in here from them. So it's differing elements, but more important, differing microbes. And now these are pits or seeds, I guess you call them, from Nanking cherries and a sour cherry that I have grown in my backyard. The Nanking cherries are from here, and then I've got some seeds in there from a sour cherry from my backyard. All right, so now I got them all in. I'm all mixed up in here. I'm going to leave it sitting here until the next time I come up. It'll probably start drying out. But all those microbes are going to be passed on to these seeds. And then I'm going to plant the seeds with these greens. In a week. I'm going to put a wet paper towel over the top of this. Leave it right inside camp here so it doesn't dry out. And I think I'll wet that paper towel with ferment water in my ferment tank. I heard about this, that the Native Americans, they actually did this for corn before they planted the corn seed. So, well, you know what? That's a really great idea. I'm going to do it with these Nanking cherry seeds and see what happens. But that's my style. I hear about a certain methodology, and then I play it to other things and what they were using it for. That just what turns my crank.
There it is.
Couldn't get the camera up fast enough. There was a hummingbird. Looked like a female getting nectar from those elephant garlic blossoms. That light green grass there in the center is wild rice. I have the cages here because sometimes I have predators here that eat it all. If I wouldn't have those cages, I wouldn't have wild rice right now. Now you can see I'm protecting some wild rice in that cage. If a predator comes along and eats all the rest of it, I've got seed to spread around. That's what I've been doing. Season 10 of actually growing wild rice here, and it's the same wild rice that I planted just before, the day before freeze up 2013. So 2014 would be the first season. 2023 is the 10th season. I have these cages here, these circle cages, because sometimes there's predators, and if I wouldn't have those cages, I wouldn't have wild rice right now. I'm ensuring that I'm going to get seed to spread around. You see the hardware cloth? That's to keep the muskrats out and the rodents out. And the 2x3-inch welded wire is to keep the deer from eating it down. In a couple weeks, I'm going to be cutting all the reeds here that I don't want to be growing so much. And I'm also going to cut the cattails around the wild rice patch. Just slow it all down. At some point, I'm not going to keep up with it, and I won't have wild rice here anymore, but that's okay. That's called natural succession. But who knows? Maybe I'll be able to keep it in check. It's all an experiment. 10 years of success so far. That hawk is really used to me. I'm just right below him. What does he got? Either put it in his talon or he swallowed it. He's just right there.
some action in this tree. It's a rootstock tree, but this is the cherries that it grows right here. Ooh, that's tart. Bird should eat it. Here's the seeds for them. Just gonna throw them in here. Here's my handiwork for caging up the service tree. I've got hardware cloth right around it. And then I have this 2x3-inch welded wire cage, and it was big enough to extend around this hazelnut and wild rose. There's actually 3 or 4 wild roses coming up in there, and that the deer were grazing pretty heavy, but now they're not going to. There's another service tree all buttoned up. I don't have a welded wire fence around it yet, but I'm gonna get one. Extend it up into this sea buckthorn canopy. I think behind it is a crab apple. Might be an apple. I don't know. Wait until it makes one, and we'll know. And here we have the third one. I have 3 more at the house that I'm nursing in a bed that's coming here. I wanted to plant these 3 first and find out what happens. The other 3 I'm going to leave there until next spring, and I'll bring them over. With the food I'm eating and the activity of planting and being outside, and you know, a lot of times I'm not working, I'm just enjoying everything. But there's also a lot of physical activity. You know, this permaculture design course that I participated in, I might say that if you follow, you know, the dictates of the manual, you know, don't follow the originator, the founder, you know, don't follow what Mollison did, you follow what he wrote. I think that a person can live 140 years, up to 140 years, maybe 140 years, eating this good food, getting this terrific outdoor exercise, and enjoying the serenity of it all. Crazy idea! Pull these onions before it starts to rain. Each one of these represents a bulb. 76. And get these in the cabin before they get wet, because I want to dry them out. 77. And here comes the rain. Oh, I got it done just in time. Oh, yeah. Holy cow. There. Oh, yeah.
when we spread these out. Try this.
They would comb them now. One, two.
Drying the potato onions that I just harvested. Here they are. $211 on a very small area. Look at that.
Super size. Super size. Well, I took a right instead of a left because I want to get closer to the road. I've been hearing rumbles of thunder. And look what I lucked into. That's a lot. That's a lot of berries just in this little spot. And they're nice size ones. I should be able to fill that right here. The road gets easier. So the angst that I suffered with the big storm coming in never materialized, but right at the end it got very windy and that pushed me out of the beds. Of course, it's getting pretty dark anyway. Ended up with 2 1/3 quarts. Alright. I really believe my eyes. Here on public land, there is an apple tree right along the road. I never noticed it. So we'll have to see when they start dropping off here. I'll have to scout around here, see if there's a spot to set up on. It's a large tree too, really old tree. Well, that hummingbird was here again, and I couldn't get the camera up fast enough. My camera has been penetrated with humidity. That ring is on the inside of the lens. It's pretty humid. It's going to get worse. All week is predicted to be high humidity and chance of, 40-50% chance of thunderstorms every afternoon. So our dry period is over. Red hardy lily plant that I planted Friday night when I arrived. Cost $16. I got it on eBay. This winter rye is very tight yet. This is very small seeded. It's just the wildlife and a soil reconstruction measure. He's pretty friendly. He doesn't not bothered by me. He landed on a branch right on our side of balsam.
He's gonna put something in here. It's an oak. The neck. I wonder if that's a chinkapin.
Out of the goldenrod and the canary grass pops this hazelnut. I planted quite a few in here and I thought they were all dead. But this has happened before. Where all of a sudden there's a hazelnut. There might have been 100 planes that have flown overhead so far. Kind of thinking the EAA is over and they're heading for another adventure somewhere. I was gonna take a nap, but sometimes I just don't get what I want. More weeks, I'm going to harvest all of this reed patch and use it as mulch on the garden. Don't have to buy any straw. Bought a pond lily and planted it in this pond that I've been working on. Since it rained, the clay loosened up and allowed me to see the deer prints. The deer that are walking by. Little fawn print there. So that little fawn is still alive. been 2 days since I've been here, and look at the growth on the clover. Just in 2 days with that rain. Holy cow. Winter rice coming in. Easy to notice this area here gets afternoon shade. It's 4 o'clock now. Muck. Shade doesn't mean dark. Shade just means less light. Let's see where a deer ate this off. Still eating on those onions a little bit. That's good. I want them to eat onions. Oh, look at these. These are spring onions. These are going to maybe make some seed. I think they're growing right at the transition where it's clay to the dirt or soil. Horizon B, Horizon A. And they want to make seed. I've planted it before, but I never took track of it. But that clover inside there looks nice. It's rained enough to fill up that little depression there. I was going to plant wild rice in it, but there's been so dry conditions that I haven't. Water level on the pond is up. Must have been a downpour. And this is one of those hazelnuts that was hidden in the canary grass here and just sprung out of it after I thought it was dead. And guess what? Yeah, some of those large hazelnuts. Assuming I get them before something else does. These are called Precocious European American Hybrid. All singles. This might not be the first year this bush has made some nuts. That's nuts. This represents the best potato onion picking I've ever had, harvest I've ever had. Lots of big ones too. Look at that, just a big pile. So you gotta put them in these containers, I'm gonna be heading for home. So I've bent that skewered over the top now so it doesn't dry out so much, but this is the bed that I grew them in. The largest ones were here and they were, say, 8 inches apart. And then I get to here and they were 2 and 3 inches apart and they still weren't bad. They weren't as large, but they weren't smalls either. Right here, these were the ones. They were really close. Let's see how much. That's probably about 2 foot wide. I gotta bring a ruler next time. So each step is more or less, you know, 3 feet a yard. 1, 2, 3, probably 3.5. So I'd say 10, 11 feet, something like that. I'll bring a ruler. All those onions came out of that. That's just terrific. So I'm heading for home. I had enough.